The expectation and the idea is that great learning will function as an independent unit, within the Byju's ecosystem and group, with our focus on the professional learning and higher education segment. Right, so that's a new segment for the Byju's group, and so we will continue to lead the charge in that segment. Right, so as such, there isn't a whole lot of integration that is being planned, except for certain key strategic aspects, and so that certain support that we get from the overall group, and resources that we have access to, and so forth. But otherwise, there isn't any kind of major integration that is planned. As far as team is concerned, the entire team is there and doing what they have been doing, and as a team, we've been growing ourselves. In the last 15 months, we have gone from 500 to 1500 people, and so that continues. We are recruiting every month to support our growth and to support the various initiatives that are happening, and that will continue to grow. That's kind of how it happened. We started a capital raising process to support our various growth initiatives that got created based on the changes that happened during the pandemic. So we started a process, and we were engaged with financial investors first, and then there was some interest from strategics. And as we evaluated those, we realized that for our what we want to do, and for the what we were looking for, there's a better fit with the strategic partnership rather than a financial partnership, and that's why we chose to go this route. So one of the reasons, if you recall, the path that we took was that we always put quality and learning outcomes ahead of everything else. So our student success, learning outcomes, quality of our programs, that has always been paramount for us. And that required us to have a long-term view always, right? So, and sometimes it has required us to, focus on making the trade-off between growth versus quality, right? So, and given that is how we want to think about it, that is how we want to continue to operate, we felt that a strategic partnership would be much more long-term focused. Right. So here, there isn't the same kind of focus on IRRs and, returns and exits and all of those kinds of things, which are all fair when you think about a financial perspective. Right. So but we want to have a very long term view. The problem that we are trying to solve, I think, is a very big problem. It's not something that can get, solved in, 1 or 2 years. So we want to be making investments, and we want to be making decisions that are oriented in the long term. And I think those we felt can be better done when we have this kind of arrangement, where, there is no kind of pressure on exit. So in some sense, it was always known that the K-12 market is a very large market. Right. But there were always questions about how big is the professional learning market. Right. So what the pandemic has shown is that people who have digital skills, people who are upskilling, they are doing better than those that aren't. Right. So it actually put focus and spotlight on that. Right. And also because people got time, working from home, not commuting, a lot more people engaged with us and people that are in our segment. And once you have people that, suddenly you realize, this is actually not what we thought it was. This is actually 10 times bigger or 20 times bigger, 50 times bigger, right? Like that realization everybody got. So that is one thing that happened. The second thing is the entire higher education ecosystem, right? When things went online, it actually put spotlight on the fact that higher education is quite a bit behind when it comes to technology adoption. Okay. And we all know the struggles that, universities and colleges and all went through, right? That also showed that there is a dire need of adoption of technology, right? And that realization has been had by all the stakeholders in the ecosystem, right? So, in fact, our government took very proactive steps by, by formulating the national education policy. If you notice, that technology plays a very prominent role, in the national education policy. Online learning, blended learning, these are terms that weren't in, popular use earlier, right? So they have all become mainstream, right? So there's been a significant boost that these these things have gotten through our own policymakers, and you know, I think them realizing and recognizing the importance of you know, doing these activities if we want to improve our gross enrollment ratio, if we want to improve access to quality education, right? And so they have also now permitted the top universities to do programs online and to have online. So higher education is also now moving online. That's another massive shift that is happening, right? And in making that shift happen, we can support these universities. We can actually help the ecosystem make that shift because we are very well positioned to do that. We've invested, you know, tens of millions of dollars in building the technologies, the assets, the content, all of those things that will go into making this happen. For any one university to do that will be very difficult, right? So the universities have their advantages. We have the strengths that we bring. And so it's a great partnership to actually use to improve access to people at an affordable price. If you notice, online education is also much more affordable than on campus, right? On campus, if you have to build, you know, per student, it costs about 10 lakhs of investment to create infrastructure on campus. So that is why the focus on, you know, on this space. In our user base, we have had a 15 times increase, you know, from pre-COVID to now, right? So, and that there's no slowing in that, you know. In fact, the rate at which we are adding people to the platform is actually increasing, right? So what it took us to go from, you know, X to Y is that took like 12 months is now happening in 6 months, right? So that pace of, you know, increase is actually accelerating, and it's coming both from India as well as from around the world, right? Because similar dynamics that are there in India are there everywhere, you know. So yes, there are some countries, you know, highly developed countries where a lot of investments in technology and education have happened, but there are many, many countries which are either at the similar situation as India or even worse, right? So all of those folks need help and are looking for solutions. And I think as companies who have kind of cut their teeth and who have gotten experience in the Indian market, you know, we are well positioned to offer this to other global markets as well. I think for us, it's right now it's kind of 60-40, you know, and because India is also a very large market, right? So there's a lot of learners that are there. And I think it's a direction that it is going. India, given our demographics, given our strength, India has the opportunity to be kind of the digital professionals hub for the world. Okay, so for them now they're learning something else so that they can work in that area, right? So there are many people like that. There are also people who have done the degree in the area they want but haven't learned it well enough, or it hasn't been practical enough for them to get a good job. So they want to learn the practical skills that can get them a job and get them a better job. Okay, so there is that. Then there are people who are kind of mid-career professionals, you know, who have been doing something, but whatever that they are doing is becoming obsolete. So they actually need to learn new skills, right? They have to learn something new. So that is a third type. Then there's a fourth type where the nature of how they are doing things is changing. They may be doing the same job, but how the job is getting done is actually changing substantially. Right. If you think about, let's say, you know, application developers that were there, you know, the way applications were built 10 years back to now has dramatically changed. Right. So these people actually need to learn how to do those things. So that's the fourth kind of learner that is there. And then the fifth kind is actually people who want to shift careers midstream. Right. They have done something and then they want to actually shift for whatever reason, either because they don't see a bright future for them in this direction or because they, you know, got interested in something else. So there are many different reasons why people are doing this, you know, and of course, we even have people like, you know, 70-year-olds who are learning. They are just doing for the love of learning, to make a point. Right. But there are many different reasons why different kinds of folks are doing this. In the beginning, what we saw was that it was all about the, you know, the most kind of cutting edge buzzwords. Okay, so it started with kind of business analytics and then data science, machine learning, artificial intelligence, cyber security, IoT, Internet of Things, blockchain, like people learning all of these technologies and how to use them to solve practical problems in various settings. So first, it was kind of that. Then the second wave was, it's less about the technologies, but more about how they are used in various businesses. Okay, so and that's a very natural technology evolution life cycle, right? In the beginning, it's more about the technology, but as it matures, the technology becomes second. The first is the application. And of course, there's always been focus on, just technology professionals upskilling themselves, right? Because there are new technologies that keep coming up all the time. So that's something that's been steady. What goes into that keeps changing, but technology upskilling is a constant thing. That's always going to be there. Okay. Then the last thing that is kind of becoming more and more prominent is completely non-technology people that have nothing to do with technology, now beginning to see how various applications of technology can improve their work, right? All functions are getting, in some sense, disrupted by technology. All functions. If anything, the pandemic has actually, shown that the businesses that have adopted technology are actually doing better. So that's actually put pressure on others to adopt as well. Being bootstrapped also means that, we had a very strong focus on, alignment of mission and the sacrifices that requires, right? So most of the early people and the founders and all of those, had either no compensation or below market compensation, right? So there are many things for which we took the hard route of actually solving problems, without using money to solve it, by solving it the way it should be solved. Right. So all of those things require tremendous amount of effort, sacrifice, all of those things.